First off, before I stand, and we'd like to thank you for letting us have this opportunity to, you know, make you a little bit more aware about people that are in wheelchairs and to be more comfortable around them because they are people just like us. And if Ron doesn't play really well tonight because he's an excellent athlete, it's for one or for two reasons. He's never played on carpet before, and we went on a 10-mile hike today, so we're both a little exhausted, and I'm really out of shape. And I'm going to read my introduction because he's really a special person, and I want to say really nice things. So I had to write it out 4 times. And my husband's name is Ron Van Elswyk, and he was born June 12, 1960 in Palmerston, Ontario. He's the oldest of 7 children, and he has 5 sisters, so he had his fill of women, so he's a darn good husband. And he was one of those boys that just loved the outdoors, dirt riding his bike all the time, and he mostly loved to run. His mom said everywhere he would just be running, running, running. She could hardly keep him down. He also gave a really hard burst, so she knew he was going to be important one day. And on one winter day in January 1977, all that changed, or did it. As we look at Ron's life and the things he's accomplished, we'll see that nothing really changed because he's in a wheelchair. He was in a car accident that altered his life. He still ran everywhere, but this time he ran on 4 wheels. Ron never gave up. He worked hard and trained until he became a top wheelchair athlete. He has competed in such events as swimming, track and field, and basketball. He has competed all over the world in such places as England, Australia, Halifax, Puerto Rico, many other areas throughout the United States and Canada. He holds a Canadian swimming record for the 100 freestyle and has held other records in track and field also that have now been beaten. He has been chosen for the national team and has competed in all national events for 15 consecutive years. He has had the opportunity to meet some very famous people, such as Prince Charles, Lady Di, Princess Fergie, and Prince Andrew, and also Wayne Gretzky, which is my hero, so that was cool. And for track and field, he competes in the 200, 400, 800, 1500, 3000, 5000, and the marathon. He has performed and was chosen for the Olympic team, and he's performed in the Gold Cup games and the Stoke Mandeville games, which are usually all in foreign countries. Currently, he plays national wheelchair basketball, which is the same as NBA, except that you're in a wheelchair, and he'll explain a little bit more about that. He plays for a team from Ontario, Canada. They're called the Twin City Spinners, and I'd like you to meet my husband, Ron Van Elswyk.
Thank you very much, Blake. this is every time I do one of these things, it's always different, so I'm not sure if I stumble about forgiving me and it'll just take the time to go. Anyhow, as she mentioned, I'm involved with a lot of sports, and but maybe just a little bit of what was involved in my life and how I came into a wheelchair, just to talk about that. Like was already mentioned, I was very active in sports before I got hurt, and enjoyed it a lot. At all. Things and all that sort of stuff, and I was just here every evening on the road riding kid, I guess. And then I had a car accident. We were involved with a snowstorm. I guess you guys get snow here too, you know. So it was a blizzardy day. We were out of school that day, and my mother, my dad, my sister, and I were on the road and got into a whiteout. I guess you all know what a whiteout is. We stopped. My mother was driving. She stopped the car, and just as she had stopped, my sister and I were going to get out and sort of direct her up the road because we just couldn't see them. At that time, a truck had rear-ended us and pushed us up the road quite a ways. And anyhow, because of that crash, it caused a lot of internal problems to me. Spleen was happening, and I had a collapsed lung. So I was hurting a little bit, and at the time I thought I was going to die. I told my dad, I'm not going to make it. I piece about that, just because, well, the way that I was raised, with my parents, they're Christian-type people, and I was brought up in a Christian home, and that kind of put an encouragement to be in peace at that time. And so anyhow, that's how I felt at that time. It was all, when you're in an accident, you're all blurry. It was, at first I thought I was dreaming, and I came to, we were all knocked out, we came to, and it's like, what's going on, and why am I still in bed? It's the middle of the day, I should be at school. So things started coming to me, and eventually I knew what happened, and took an ambulance ride to the hospital, and as soon as I got there, they did an operation on me for about 7 hours, they say, and tried fixing up stuff. And after the operation is when they discovered that I had no feeling or I couldn't move my legs. And they weren't sure why I could still do it before I got to the hospital. And they told me it was this and that, it's pinched nerves, it's all kind of things, they'll come back in 2 weeks. But I was in the hospital for a month recuperating from my internal damage and that sort of stuff. They moved me to the therapy floor, which is a rehab type floor. And there, that's where, it was a month later, the doctor came to my room one day and said, well, you're never going to walk again, so get used to that idea. We're going to work with you and get you so that you can function in life from a wheelchair. It came as a shock. That was a hard day. I was thinking, just before this, I want to get out of here and get back into jogging schedule. And at that time, roller skating was a big thing for us. I loved roller skating. I thought, I can't wait to get back to that friend and roller skating. And different things like that. So it was a bit of a hard day. They left me on my own for that day, and I had my tears. But from that day on, it was just a matter of, well, this is life, and it's what can I do? I may have to go for it and do what I can. So I worked really hard, and they told me I'd be in the hospital about 6 to 8 months in therapy. And I kept working at it, and in 3 months I'd pretty well done as much as they wanted me to do, so I could go out and get back involved with my life. And there was never some of the other guys that were there, they tend to get very depressed. There's always a time when you just seem to go through this real depression time. And I also have some friends that I met later on through basketball. They get so depressed that all they would do is sleep all day and wouldn't get out of bed. And I remember being in a meeting one day with all the doctors and the therapists. They were saying, why hasn't this guy gone through this? It was a natural phase that everyone went through. I had never experienced that, and I'm thankful that I did. Reasons, I think I believe in the power of prayer. I had a lot of people praying for me, and I think it kept me from that really deep depression. That's something that I'm thankful for. And although there's times, like everybody, that those times, and oh, I wish I could do this or that the next thing, but not that I go for a day to be silent and just be depressed. That's something I'm very thankful for. And anyhow, from that point on, it was a matter of changing schools, going to a different school, and meeting some new friends, and it's something I never did well. Meeting friends was never a big thing for me, but I got involved with basketball, and that's where I met other people that were in wheelchairs, and was able to make some friends and people that I could identify with and share some of my problems with, and how you go about things, and well, this is where I was coming. A big thing getting involved in sports with other people, chairs. And I guess just as before I get into a little bit about the sports things, there's a verse that sort of is with me. It's goes, you're all familiar with it. Those are heavy. I can just think of it, but I can't now. You just mentioned it one day. But anyhow, those that have a burden or anything, come on, ask Christ and he'll give you rest. I found that true in my life. When I get a real downtime, if I get into a situation where I just, why this and why that, I bring it towards him. But anyhow, as far as sports goes, there's different sports for different disabilities. I'm what we call paraplegic, and it's a spine. It's the same as someone breaking their bone, but their back. But there's other sports where the blind or people that are got amputations, and we run a lot of these things sort of together when sports first was, when I was first involved, and now it's pro golf and it's more special. A little bit about blind sports. It's a really interesting thing to see because these guys are blind. Normally in a demonstration, I have blindfolds and blindfold two people and get them running around and doing different things. And one of the races, the 100-meter dash, when you're completely blind, they have a code or a system that they use. They run down the track, and their coach is at the other end of the track, and they use these system of numbers, 4, 5, and 6. As long as you're running straight down the track, the coach is backing up as much as he can while the runner's coming at him. And as long as the runner's coming straight down the track, he gets the whole track to himself. They only run one at a time. He's yelling 5, 5, 5, 5. And as soon as the runner starts to veer off a little bit to this way, the coach will say 6, 6, 6 until he gets back on track, 5, 5, 5. He's over this way, it's 4, 4, 4, 5, 5, 5. And it's a really interesting race to watch, but you just see this guy beeline down the track. And try it on day one, hold yourself, see how fast you'll run. You'll hopefully where you're fastest at. And it's really interesting to see. And also for the longer races, what they do is, as they're running, they have another person, what they call them. It's just someone that they train with, and they lightly touch their wrist, and as they're running around the track with this other guy, just lightly touching the wrist. And so some of these guys, they find it hard to find someone that can keep up with them, because they really go. And the person that's going with them has to be this kind of good shape as the runner. And they move along. It's an interesting race to see. And then there's the amputee sports. You get guys with no arms, one arm, one leg, no legs. They're all different classes. And to make it fair, some with one leg doesn't compete with some with no legs because that's not fair. And so they put him in different classes. And there's a guy, John Bolton, Arnold, I can't remember how to interpret his names, but anyhow, he only had one leg. And I watched him high jump, and he could jump over 6 feet on one leg. And when you see this guy, I used to high jump before I got hurt. And I was really impressed because I could jump 5 feet, which was the height that I lived. And here you see a guy on one leg jump over 6 feet, and he was only like, I think maybe 5 feet, a little over 5 feet himself. So there's some things that if you really train hard and work at it, you can do a lot of things in common. The rules for basketball are all the same as able-bodied basketball, except for we're allowed 3 seconds. In the key, we're allowed 5 seconds. Normally, you're only allowed 3 seconds. The reason for 5 is when you get 10 wheelchairs out on the court. If you're caught in the key, you can't find the hole and dart out, so you can lose a few extra seconds to get out of the key. And also, we don't have no double dribble, I guess is what you call it. Normally, in able body, AB, call able ball. That's you guys. If you stop, you have to pass the ball off to someone. Wheelchair basketball, you can stop and go again. But we do have a travel. And maybe I'll just jump out of a chair and go through a few things. Okay, as you all know, this is a ball.
And one of the things that, well, first of all, you've noticed this is a basketball chair. That's my everyday chair. You'll see that there's some differences. First of all, you notice that the wheels are on an angle. We call that a camber, and what it does, one thing it does is if I do not on carpet but on a hardwood floor, if I would give this wheel one push like that, I can pretty well do a circle, whereas in that chair maybe get me maybe this far in a circle. And the camber helps me to do that also. If I'm reaching for a ball out of here, if I'm in that chair and doing it, I'd be on my face right now. And it keeps you from tipping over. You'll also notice that there's these things on it, and everyone wonders what those are for. It's mostly it's a spoke guard, because you get a lot of guys that come up to you and crash into your wheels and take out 5 spokes while you're pretty well done for the game, where that keeps you from losing those. Also, there's no push handles on this chair, and that chair, for me to get up and down steps and to get around in life, I need someone to get me up steps. So the handles help, whereas this chair, you don't want a handle on it because your hand on the ball up here and out here and doing whatever, you don't want to get tied up in the handles. And there's little roller wheels on the front. That's mostly to save the floor. If you're going down, I don't know if you can see it because my feet are kind of big. If you end up tipping forward, it keeps the floor from getting scratched up. So those are some of the differences. I don't know if you notice anything. Anyone notice any difference between this chair and that one, other than the color?
Yeah,
it's a lower backrest. Everyone has a different, depending on your injury, you have a lower backrest or a higher. I guess I'll explain. I'm considered a one, and someone that has more balance than myself, my balance isn't real good. I can lean down like this, but I can't quite get up, whereas someone with more stomach muscles would be able to get right up. And someone that is just missing a leg or two legs, you can bend over with two arms and then pull himself back up, where I don't have enough muscles to pull myself back up. So I don't want someone with more muscles than two and someone that is much more, it would cost 3. And you're only allowed 12 points on the pool. And that makes it fair that you can only, otherwise you can put all these class 3s on, which are normally usually physically a better player. You have a question?
Okay, you don't have the muscles because of your injury?
Yeah, my injury is, that's my level is T9. And from everything there down, I don't have any muscles that I can use. And there are some guys that are a T5, which is right across the chest, so they even have fewer muscles. But I'm right on the border of being a 2. And someone that's a 1, they can be, well, almost up to the chest somewhere. Yeah, if there's any questions.
You mentioned you could only have 12 points?
Yeah, only 12 points on the floor, so...
or 5 people, or...?
Yeah, and there has to be 5 people, too, unless you come shorter.
But the coach has got to...
Yeah, so you're always trying to barrel the only points, so after a while, put on...
Yeah, you get a technical foul if you have too many points on the floor.
Yeah, they'll give you a key. And there's also another technical foul is... I can't cheat because I don't have the muscles, where someone that has one leg, they can push themselves up and hold themselves there. And if a referee sees that they're doing that, they'll get a technical foul.
Height dependent?
Yeah,
it's called a PAF, which is a personal advantage foul. You see, Ron couldn't do it, so that's why.
That's just to make it fair for him. Also, myself, I get a lot of stabs and my feet want to jump around and sometimes go out in the air and do a little dance. Performance. And so I use time down to scrap. I normally have scraps around my knees also. I don't have them with me. And that keeps my legs from, like, if I start doing this sort of stuff, my knees are flopping around. So I don't normally, I've dealt it in good and solid. And there's times when you do get dumped out of your chair or whatever. I'm in my chair so much with scraps that I can be dumped on the floor. And my chair stays right with me and I can really push myself back up and keep on going. And then, but then there's other guys. I have a friend who's an aunt from, just below his knees, and he'll be trying to defend someone and hit him and go slide out of his chair and be half a mile down the court from his chair sometimes. But that doesn't matter. One of the things is, how do you a matter of using your wheel. The wheel is around, the ball is around, so it picks up real easy. If it's stationary or if it's rolling, you can do the same thing. And that's how you get the ball up. It's pretty easy to go that way. And then when you're trying to get real fancy, you try to work this in and throw it like so, and try to take out the preserving thing. I went over the rules already. I guess the matter, I'll shoot you.
Can you clarify your dribbling rules?
Dribbling is we're allowed 2 pushes, 1, 2, 1.5 the bounce of the ball, and then 2 more pushes, I'm allowed, and then I can dribble. Once I move, I can be worried about dribbling and pushing at the same time, because if you have a ball in your lap and someone's going to be around you, they're going to knock it off, so it's better that you can be dribbling and pushing at the same time. It's a matter of practice. And yeah, talking to people that have never done it before, it's like, how do you dribble the ball? And once they see it, it's, well, it does take a little practice. What I'll do is just run through a few little different, I'll do 2 layups or so, and take a few foul shots so you can get a good idea of what it looks like from a chair, and then maybe I'll pick on someone to try it also, and just so you can feel what it's like. Layups are the same. I get my 2 pushes if I need them. That's from the right side. The left side, you shoot a little harder. Yeah, who here plays basketball or likes, or?
We got a couple of people.
Well, we'll get a guy and a girl over here. Just normally I have some other demonstrations that I do that I'm not really prepared to do tonight. That I get people trying wheelchairs, but tonight I'll just be able to do a few things in basketball.
We usually have a video too, but we weren't really prepared.
Yeah, I have a little basketball, a video of a team playing, and like I'm here by myself, so you can't see all the different, like we have our regular pick and rolls and all our different defenses, man-to-man presses, sagging man, all the regular defenses that you have, and all our offensive plays. We were going to have so many plays that they'd call up numbers and say, oh, you have to think for a while, which one is that? Because we'd have all these different plays that we do. But anyhow, let's get a guy in here. Who had their hands up? Jump in here. Chair is also very tippy. If you tend to lean back too far, you might dunk. Okay, you're not too bad. Here's a ball.
We want to see it dunk.
What's that?
We want to see
it dunk. Okay, go for it. Anyhow, see if you can do what I was saying. Take your two pushes and then dribble the ball and go take a shot. There's two pushes.
I think he knew you were going to say that. Oh, he wanted to. He just wanted to.
The reason I have it so tiny is I like a lot of weight on the back wheels, because when you're flying up the court and I want to turn, if all the weight's on the front wheels, well, I'll just sort of keep on going. So I like to crank back into it and turn it around. That's why I like the tipping. I know it's tippier than most guys, but so
you were able,
on your head.
You were able to design that yourself, or?
There, my chair is all adjustable.
Good try. I do the same thing.
Okay, try that. Remember, your two pushes, and then you can dribble it, and you got it down.
Do you know this?
Just about ready to end.
He's got a nice shot.
Ooh.
Watch him dribble.
Hey, kind of do a layup there. You try to square up. Here we go. I can see it
coming.
There's a lot more to him than the kids.
Oh, you can see it.
Tall. They don't have enough weight.
It's a lot more person that's practice to get the thing down. Someone was asking before, I don't know if you all heard, wheelchair, you buy them, and this chair is all completely adjustable. I can raise the wheels up or down, I can make it longer, shorter, so it's adjustable, so I can make it how I like. And once, some guys have a completely solid chair and nothing moves on it, and it's once they really know what they want, which I guess, well, I like the adjustability because I'm fussy, and I like it just so. It's a solid frame chair though. This chair that I'm in folds up, I can put it in my car behind the seat easily. Whereas this chair, the wheels pop off really easily. And that's how you get around with it. Just to demonstrate. There's a wheel off. And once both wheels are off, also the backrest does fold down. That's why you can move your car or move it around. When we travel with a team, we usually rent one van for all us guys to jump in one van with chairs piled in. And it's a matter of just popping off two wheels and hopefully getting your same wheels back. That's where Kari, she's come along on some trips where you can take one able-bodied person just to help out with taking chairs apart, putting them together. And that's her job when she gets to come along on a team. And the team always brings along one person. And also, at first when I got into it, it was a little expensive. We had to pay out of our own pocket, but as the years went by, the team developed and was able to raise enough money so that all your travel and accommodation and food is paid for, and that makes it nice. Because we were able to go to some tournaments. First we were just playing locally, and then we spread out, and now we're through all United States. There's about 150 teams throughout the states. And I play for a team in Canada, close to Toronto, and we ranked in the top 10. That's what we've been trying to do for the last 5 years or so, to stay in the top 10. So we get to go to some high-caliber tournaments. I had a question.
Did your team like have a name?
Yeah, we're called the Twin City Spinners. It's I live in Kitchener-Waterloo, which is called the Twin Cities, so we just say Twin City Spinners. And there's all the different kind of names. A lot like a regular basketball ball.
Like the Spitfire.
Well, but then there's the rollers and the scope benders.